how does this play out practically in terms of an interactive exercise of authority by the Competition Commission and the Controller of Patents? When the aspect of abuse of dominance by a standard essential patentee is brought to the attention of the Competition Commission, the Commission has the power to look into the to those aspects of the patentee's conduct which amount to abuse within the meaning of Section 4. However, where the issue relates to the aspect of royalty setting, to the extent that the issue relates to actual price fixation, Section 21A of the Competition Act permits the Competition Commission to outsource or farm out royalty setting or price setting to an authority such as the Controller of Patents, who may in turn invoke the aspect of compulsory licensing under Section 84, subject of course to the satisfaction of conditions under Section 84. In other words, let's take a situation where a patentee chooses to engage in multiple discussions, a standard essential patentee chooses to engage in multiple discussions with multiple third parties on price fixation or on royalty fixation, and does not let each of these parties speak to each other so that they do not ever know whether each of them has been offered the same or similar set of royalties or similar royalty schedules. In such a situation, if there is an NDA that is imposed on each of these parties by the standard essential patentee, which prevents them from talking to each other, it makes it impossible, at least legally, for each of these parties to verify the FRAND compliance of the royalty that has been shared with them by the patentee. Since one of the obligations on a standard essential patentee is to offer non-discriminatory terms to similarly placed parties, the effect of an NDA that prevents the parties from speaking with each other is to prevent them from verifying whether or not they have indeed been offered non-discriminatory terms. Therefore, this aspect of the issue where the patentee creates silos of information and prevents parties from talking to each other typically falls within the realm of abuse of dominance, and this aspect of his conduct is best decided or adjudicated by the Competition Commission and not the Controller of Patents, because the Controller of Patents can limit himself to only three aspects which have been provided for under Section 84, namely reasonable affordability, access requirements, and any other reasonable requirements of the public. The aspect of using an NDA to prevent flow of information and to use the asymmetry in the information to the advantage of the patentee is not something that can be adjudicated by the Controller of Patents invoking the compulsory licensing mechanism. Therefore, the best way forward would be for the Competition Commission to take cognizance of those aspects which don't deal with the aspect of price fixation, and to farm out those aspects which relate to price fixation to the Controller of Patents. However, in doing so, the question that must be again asked is whether the Competition Commission is barred by the Competition Act or the provisions of the Competition Act from setting royalties. In my humble opinion, Section 27 and 28 read together, which enumerate the powers of the Competition Commission to deal with situations of anti-competitive agreements and abuse of dominance, abundantly provide for a wide range of powers, including the power to create interest or to create titles in favor of third parties. So, for instance, when one deals with the aspect of abuse of dominance, the Competition Commission has the following powers. One is to divide the abusive entity in such a way that the resultant entities are never in a position to abuse their positions or are never in a dominant position at all. In the alternative, it also has the power to create interest in favor of third parties to ensure that the right which gives rise to a position of dominance to the dominant player is no more within the power of the patentee. So, for instance, if a standard essential patent is the reason for lending a position of dominance to a patentee or to an enterprise, it is within the power of the Competition Commission to create a license in favor of third parties on reasonable terms to prevent the abuse of the patent. In fact, if there are agreements that that have already been entered into which are abusive in nature, the Competition Commission also has the power to rewrite the terms of the agreement to prevent future abuse. In light of these broad powers of the Competition Commission, it could be said that in stark contrast to the position taken by antitrust regulators in Europe and the United States, Indian competition regulator, which is the Competition Commission, appears to have the power to set prices as well. The question that could be then asked is whether the Competition Commission has the wherewithal to deal with aspects of price setting. The Competition Commission is inherently positioned or is inherently better placed to deal with aspects of price setting than the controller of patents. Of course, it could be said that the controller of patents probably has the requisite subject matter expertise or the domain expertise to understand the nature of the invention. But be that as it may, nothing stops the Competition Commission from seeking opinions of subject matter experts in understanding the nature of an invention before creating rights in favor of third parties by way of licenses. Now, this is insofar as it relates to conflict of jurisdiction. The other aspect of standard essential patent litigation, which has a serious bearing on competition law, is the very act of institution of suits of infringement and the very act of seeking exclusionary reliefs by a standard essential patentee against third parties. There is a brilliant paper that has been written by Mark Lemley and by other experts on the subject, who have gone on to opine that the very holding of a standard essential patent deprives the patentee of his right to seek exclusionary reliefs against a third party, since any grant of an exclusionary relief in favor of a standard essential patentee and against a defendant would end up creating a serious disparity in negotiating powers between the parties on the issue of royalty fixation and could end up hastening the process or tilting the process in favor of the patentee. This is one of the reasons that courts the world over and competition regulators the world over have frowned upon the grant of interim injunctions or any form of exclusionary relief in a situation which deals with standard essential patent, considering that it has the consequence, or it could have the consequence, of completely tilting market conditions in favor of the patentee to the detriment of all third parties. However, this is not an absolute or blanket ban on the grant of intellectual on the grant of interlocutory reliefs. The nuanced position that has been taken the world over is this: should the third party demonstrate his blatant and brazen unwillingness to secure a license, despite having been given ample material to satisfy himself on the issues of validity of the patents, on the issues of essentiality of those patents, and after having been offered rates which are reasonable, fair, and non-discriminatory, it is certainly within the power of the courts to grant interim injunctions against a defendant. It is certainly within the right of the patentee to seek exclusionary reliefs against such an unwilling licensee. However, the burden of proving that the defendant has been an unwilling licensee lies on the patentee, considering that he holds a monopoly which gives him extensive market power. In stark contrast, in other litigations, one would expect the defendant to be put in a position where he has to show that he has been reasonable. In a situation which concerns a standard essential patent, the obligation is on the patentee who seeks an exclusionary relief to show that he has no other option but to seek exclusionary relief, since the defendant is an unwilling licensee. This is an interesting area that is under development in India and is and will hopefully be adjudicated upon in the course of the next few months, considering that there are a lot of standard essential patent litigations that are underway before the Delhi High Court. However, a standard essential patent litigation probably is a good test of the robustness and the flexibility of the competition regime to address several aspects. For instance, it helps us understand whether or not the Competition Commission can comment on the propriety of invocation of statutory reliefs by an intellectual property owner. So, for instance, on one hand, you have the argument of the intellectual property owners, such as standard essential patentees, who claim that they have the statutory right under individual IP legislations or patent legislations to sue defendants for infringement should the defendant use their technology without their consent. And on the other hand, you have arguments under competition law, which say that in the context of a standard essential patent, which lends a position of dominance to its owners, the exercise of intellectual property rights or the exercise of statutory reliefs cannot be viewed in isolation and cannot be looked at through the prism of exercise of IP, exercise of statutory reliefs alone, considering its significant ramifications or consequences for market on market players and on other stakeholders, including consumers. The middle path that could be taken is, unless and until there is a demonstration of malafides by the defendants to a reasonable offer by the patentee, it would be unfair and it would be an act of abuse by a patentee to seek exclusionary reliefs seems to be the right way forward, considering that it does justice to the patentee's right to seek remuneration for the use of his technology, and it also balances the equally compelling interests of the defendant, who says that unless and until he is convinced of the quality of the patent and its relevance to his product, he does not have the need, or he does not have, he is under no obligation to seek a license. One of the decisions that I would certainly request people to read is the decision of Ringo versus ZTE, which was passed in 2013, or which was pronounced in 2013 by the UK Court of Chancery, the UK Chancery Court. Now, the UK Chancery Court actually took a very nuanced position and accepted the defendant ZTE's position that merely because the defendant chooses to challenge the validity of a patent which has been asserted under which has been asserted against him in the context of a standard essential patent litigation, he cannot be treated as an unwilling licensee, because the position that he takes amounts to this: should the patent pass muster on a scrutiny by the court, and should the patent be adjudged as valid, and should the patentee offer a rate which is otherwise fair, reasonable, and non-discriminatory, he will have no other option but to take a license. But in the event of the patentee failing on any one of these anvils, there is no obligation on him to seek a license for the patent, merely because the patentee himself has declared that his patent is a standard essential patent. The one important aspect that needs to be explained here is this: standard setting organizations typically do not take upon themselves the responsibility of adjudicating any claim of essentiality or even the validity of the patent. In which case, apart from the self-serving declaration of a patentee that his patent is a standard essential patent, there is no other way of testing the validity of a patent conclusively other than by challenging its validity before the court of law in a counterclaim for revocation, or before the IPAB by way of a revocation petition. Unfortunately, the tendency today appears to be that any challenge to the validity of a patent is treated as a sign of unwillingness on the part of the defendant to seek a license. This, in my humble opinion, would be the incorrect approach to a situation such as this, where there are multiple interests, and it would be unfair to view the litigation purely from the patentee's point of view. One hopes that during the course of the development of jurisprudence on intellectual on standard essential patent litigation and its anti-competitive and its competition implications, we get to understand the nature of intellectual property rights better, and the actual scope of enforcement that is permissible within the framework of both IP legislations and competition law. And we also get to understand the scope of the competition law's powers to interfere with statutory rights and remedies, because that has an implication on the power of courts to take cognizance of suits of infringement instituted by standard essential patentees. One hopes that in the next few months we'll have a few decisions that shed light on the law on these issues. Thank you.